Funding for Return to Prairie Earth is provided by the Kansas Humanities Council, exploring history, exchanging ideas, building community. Also by Larry and Melanie Greenwood, Carl Rolick, Alan Lazarus, and the Community for Living Education.
You get a feeling from the broad horizon, from the movement, the shape of the land. You get a feeling of being at sea, and then you learn this was sea. We'd be sitting underwater now had certain global forces not done what they did. The landscape, with these low rolling hills, the landscape looks something very much like a rough sea, a sea under wind. So this is all a gift of the sea. And whenever I'm here, I'm realizing I'm walking in a way through a sea of air. Connecting road maps with the landscape I was seeing, I began doing when I was probably 9 years old, and it's the kind of thing that just clicked with me. I seem to feel a very natural kind of link. Reading maps, looking at highways, looking at the terrain, trying to put the two together, then coming home and looking at the map and trying to see the trip again, a real challenge to do by looking at a piece of highway.
I think my first time to enter the Flint Hills and cross them was in the early 50s when I was a boy serving as a navigator in my dad's 49 Pontiac. And I was stunned by leaving the woodlands of the eastern part of the Middle West and coming into this edge of the Great Plains where everything opens up. I'd never seen anything like this before, but it was sort of intimidating. And I can't say I fell in love with it then. It was a place, maybe like I think so many people today, it was a place to be passed through to get to Colorado, wherever else you were going on farther west. But after I came out of the Navy in the early 60s, after having spent 2 years looking at a horizon of water in which things were not only flat, but there wasn't much there except color, when I came back to the Flint Hills then, this looked like an incredibly complex place. And it wasn't flat here. I mean, Kansas in the popular imagination is flat. Well, I rest my case. This is not flat. And it reminded me of a truly beautiful ocean, an ocean with lots of topography to it, a green ocean. And my response flipped 180 degrees from that early impression of, oh God, let's get out of here too. I got to get back there. I found my way into writing with the idea of doing two articles for National Geographic magazine, articles that I would write and photograph, illustrated articles. The first was going to be following back roads across the country from the Atlantic Ocean to the Pacific Ocean, staying off of federal highways, the original idea was, staying along the roads that at that time in the old, some of the old road atlases were colored blue. And thinking about that, I thought, well, that wouldn't be a bad title, Across America on the Blue Roads. And not long after that, I had another idea come to me, a more local thing, when I realized how much it was going to cost to take that trip across the country. I thought, I need to get closer to home. So I started thinking about the Flint Hills, 5 hours from where I live. And I came out here and did a little reconnoitering and saw that Chase County is really far and away the best piece of the Flint Hills, the great stone architecture and these beautiful, beautiful vistas. So I thought, yeah, that would be good. I can do that more readily. But then my life fell apart, and I didn't do either one as an article. Instead, I took off on a three-month trip, which became the book Blue Highways.
This was one of the first highways I was driving in the, I guess, in the early 70s, and thinking, there's a world along this two-lane road that you would never suspect from I-35, the interstate, which is only a few miles to the east here. There's another world here. I wonder what kind of book might point that up. So in a way, Blue Highways, although it came before Prairie Earth, Blue Highways was the idea for it, was born right here along old Kansas 13. And it's a strange thing indeed to sit here now so many years later thinking about that's where all this got started. I came back and 4 years later after I'd written the book and it had been published and had reached an audience, the publisher said, what are you going to do next? And I was trying to think, what would be my next topic? And I remembered this article idea about the Flint Hills. And so I said, I think I'll write about the Flint Hills. There wasn't much out on the Flint Hills then. And so I came over and started poking around, and not only the land seemed to open up, but to a certain extent the people too, and the stories started coming in. And within a couple of trips out here, I realized this is an incredibly rich area.
He called and said that he was getting ready to write a book on Chase County, and he wondered if he could come to my office and talk to me about it. And possibly would I take him out here to introduce him to some of the people that I knew, some of the ranchers. And I said I would be happy to talk with him. And then I just rolled my eyes.
Had you heard about him before he was in the area?
Yeah, because I'd read Blue Highways. So when somebody said that he's in the area, it was like, hey, that's cool. Because I had loved Blue Highways, you know, and I really don't think I had any idea at the time the undertaking that he had for Prairie Earth. But I was also, not that interested. Intrigued, maybe, but I wasn't really focused on what he was doing with his book. I saw him several times while he was here. He did the interview and came to the ranch one day when we were working cattle. And then he came back and read the chapter to me and hoped that I wouldn't change much. That's when I thought, I probably ought to change some of that stuff, but I really did say it, so I'll try and stick with it.
I think he has an excellent interviewing technique to get people to open up and talk to him because of his ability to shift gears from being an academic, if you will, and using a large vocabulary to being a common person. And interviewing people to get them to talk to him and explain things in their own words to him. And I thought that is a good interview technique, and I thought he did a good job of that.
And so it was that beginning. I was so negative about seeing him, and I don't think even he knows that this was the case, because he's a very soft-spoken, modest man, and so we spent the lunch hour outside at my office. We have a little deck out in back, and he didn't really ever tell me his background. And so at the end, he said, "Here, I'm going to leave you something." And then he called and said, "Did I leave that packet with you?" And I said, "Well, yes, but I haven't even opened it." And he said, "But I promise that I will." So I opened it up, and here it was, the Atlantic magazine, and he's on the cover. And he never told me that he had written a book, Blue Highways, and that it was doing very well, and I read it, and that he was an exceptionally fine writer. And at that point, then I was head over heels ready to take him anywhere.
To me, he was the perfect author for the kind of book he was trying to write, because he was so laid back. To me, I found him really laid back. He'd ask a question, and then he'd just be quiet. And of course, you know me, I just gushed with answers, because I knew a lot more back then than I know now. 25 years ago, I was much smarter than I am now.
I thought, this is a chance to go into some place and stay, and not become a resident, not to become part of the community, but to be attached to it in some way. So I'm still an outsider, I'll be treated like an outsider, but to be there long enough to pursue stories. If I can show to American readers that this little old place in East Central Kansas is interesting, and it's deep in its history, deep in its past, its history, both human and natural history. If I can show that, then they're going to realize, so was my hope, they're going to realize that wherever they live, that place too is deep in history, interesting. And to get to my point here, I thought that this could be a good way to help Americans connect with the land, or in so many instances, reconnect with the land.
I think the book had a positive impact overall. I really do. Because I think it raised our self-esteem. That we thought, wow, you know, somebody could see something in us that we didn't see.
I've met people out on the street from places like Belgium and England and different places that were here because they'd read the book.
During the 11 years that I've been here at the Emma, you would be absolutely astonished at the number of people who come in from the East Coast and from Europe with this book tucked under their arm.
The story of Chase County reached the world. People around the globe slowly began to learn about one of the country's most environmentally diverse, yet sparsely populated regions. Some were even moved to uproot their lives and relocate to this 770-square-mile neighborhood.
Coincidence, you could say, but it had to happen. It was William Lee Street Moon who brought us here. I had read Blue Highways. Blue Highways became a cult book in Europe in the days that America still had quite a lot of fans in Europe. And the pages in newspapers were filled with advertisements for vacations in America. People would come here. And because I'd read Blue Highways and loved the book, we even, during vacations, traveled parts that he had traveled in Arizona, for instance. And that's why I knew that when Prairie Earth came out that I had to read that one, and I got fascinated by Prairie Earth. So I'm a promoter of the book because it changed my life.
And to build a shed, so we'll salvage everything and use it for a good purpose, you know.
See, it's a traditional art form, but I turned it into something way more.
Tone Nans Hock, originally from The Hague, bring a global perspective to the town of Matfield Green, which has doubled in population since Prairie Earth was published, from around 30 to 60.
The hills and the grasses and the buffalo, Come on out. I want you. Please keep
hey,
good. This is
you were the one who fucked up my life. Nice meeting you. I've been reading your books for 20 years now.
What in Prairie Earth made this place a spot you wanted to look at?
I think it was what you call the deep map that attracted me. I had not many times read a story about a small piece of the earth that went so deep in all the facets of it, the people, the geology, the history, the architecture, the animals, and so on and so on. And that was one of the things that opened my eyes to the value of the Midwest.
With Prairie Earth, Heat Moon wanted to set down a deep map of this community, an exploration of everything past and present, a psychogeography of people and land.
I would come into some small places, some village, a small town, and get to know a couple of people and begin to hear a little bit about the history of what was going on there. And I would begin to become attached and get interested in this place. And I'd want to stay and fill out these stories. I wanted to get an encyclopedic knowledge of a particular place. But the point of Blue Highways is a lot of places in a limited time. 13,000 miles in 3 months. But I kept wanting to stop and go deep instead of go horizontal across the country. I wanted to go vertical.
The deep map moves at the pace of the landscape, deliberate and steadfast. A pace, perhaps, in which modern America has lost interest.
That's why we need to start digging deeper in America. And from there I started thinking about one of the problems with Americans morally, ethically, environmentally, socially, is that we don't connect enough with the land itself. Mm-hmm. We don't connect enough with the depth of our history, even though it's you know, we're talking about 400 or 500 years here. In terms of Euro-American history, if we talk about Native American history included, then we go back even farther. But we as Americans, particularly Euro-Americans, we don't go back far enough. So we need something to draw people into the depths of history, and if they do that, and the land is involved, and when I say land, I'm speaking certainly immediately about soil, earth, maybe we can start connecting people with the lands. If you believe in the land, then all sorts of other actions become good or they become immoral if you belong to the land. It doesn't solve every human moral dilemma, but it takes care of a lot of them. And this feeling that so many young people have of not being connected. If you connect with the land, you're connected, and if you connect with the land, you're connected with the cosmos, given that the soil comes from the cosmos. So I wanted to try to write a book about a place that Americans thought there's nothing that happens there of interest. Uh-huh. And it happens that place is very near the very center of the 48 states.
Chase County in east central Kansas is one of several counties that make up the Flint Hills region. Formed 250 million years ago, during the Permian period, when shallow seas covered much of the western United States, the Flint Hills are erosional remnants of limestone and shale. In higher elevations, chert or flint developed within the limestone, slowing erosion, while impermeable shales erode faster in the lower elevations. Outcroppings of massive limestone settle around the hilltops, but just inches below the surface of the prairie resides millennia of rock deposits, making most of the region untillable. The tall grass prairie once covered most of the central United States and parts of Canada. Now only a fraction remains virtually undisturbed. From ocean to rock, to soil, to animals, to humans. In Chase County, Kansas, one can sense the timeline of existence at their feet. Thank you.
this entire question of depth is always in front of the writer. The question of how you penetrate to get to depth. One of the ways that I use in writing Prairie Earth, in trying to reach past souls, if you will, those who have come before us, is to imagine them. In the book, I use the term to dream them. It is not that I was usually dreaming sleep dreams of these people, but daydreaming them in a way. I would come to these places and I'd read tombstones and sometimes pick up a fact here or there about a life, and then take that fact back and assemble that with other facts that I'd gleaned from other tombstones and put them together into kind of a composite character of somebody who could be, might have been, buried in that cemetery. And it was a way of recreating a person that otherwise there was no way to do it, to bring them back, to reimagine them and their life here on the prairie. And that process, as I moved through the book, I began referring to as dream walking, a term I think that I got from reading about the Australian Aborigines and a practice of theirs. I think what I was doing probably was something different from what they do, but both of us were attempting to make a connection between the present and the past, trying to link the moment we are in here at this time with something that's lost to us, that's gone before, but yet we know it was there. We can see the signs, the penimento of the tracks of these people before. And the only way, or the major way perhaps I should say, that I would try to do that is to dream into their lives. A couple times I did have dreams about people that I'd conjured up, sleeping dreams, but most of the time it was something that I was, well, I'll say it this, it was an act of the imagination. I think it's in the first chapter of Prairie Earth. The book opens where I use a word that I took from Herman Melville's Moby Dick, loomings, because I believed at the time, as I still do, that there are issues that face our survival as a species, as a planet, which loom heavily over us. And I was hoping by coming here to a place of 774 square miles, that's a lot of land, with only 3,000 people, that things would be just a bit more clear. If they were more clear, maybe I would comprehend better. It still was a challenge to understand. But the one thing that I'm thinking about right now, two decades after I began poking around here, well, a little more than that, is that the population in Chase County has tended to stay at about 3,000. There's a sustainable population here. And that is not true of the rest of the country. I don't know what the population of America was when I began working here in 83, but if I'm not too far off the mark, I think there are about 100 million more people in America now than there were then. And that's at the most a quarter of a century. And Chase, to me, is evidence that is indeed the case, because we do have the same number of people here. Well, probably within a dozen or so, and the county now is prospering in a way it was not prospering when I first came here a quarter of a century ago. They've learned that limits can mean a better life for people.
Tallgrass Prairie has had many champions, but perhaps none as tireless as Elaine Jones. Featured in the book Prairie Earth, her introduction to Chase County was, like many others, a serendipitous discovery.
We were driving home from a football game in Oklahoma, and it was a blinding rainstorm that suddenly stopped, and I looked out the window and said, pull over. And my husband said, what's wrong? And I said, look, where are we? I mean, this is just the most amazing sight I've ever seen. And here was this enormous expanse of rolling hills and green grass and flowers, and it was just a different world. That was the introduction that I had. It was very powerful. As the environmental movement began to move into the Midwest, I saw an article in the paper and I had a chance to possibly do something. And I thought, this is exactly what I want to do for possibly the next 2 years, not dreaming that it would be a lifetime of love of this whole idea.
The idea was to establish a prairie national park in Kansas, an idea that had been talked about for years, but never realized.
So I learned about the plants and the cooperation of systems that were here that made this such a fragile and important place. As the issue began to bloom, it seemed like the last environmental project that hadn't really been written about. And so it became popular to have people come out. And so the people from Smithsonian and National Geographic and Time Life Books and bureaucrats, everybody was coming out here. During the 70s and early 80s, we had prairie conferences at Camp Wood. And we always invited the ranchers and people that were interested in what was going on out here from their own standpoint and to find out more about what we were up to. So that's when we got acquainted with ranchers, and we found them to be very sincere, very good-hearted, well-meaning, enjoyable people. And we would debate during the formal parts of the conference, and then at night we'd go dancing.
Then we had the what's known as now as the Z-Bar Ranch, which was built in the 1870s also, and it was of some interest to people like the Audubon Society, the National Park Trust, and others who thought that that particular ranch would make a good national park or preserve. And there had been some movement earlier in history in this area, which they wanted to take large tracts of land and put it into a national park system. And that movement met with a lot of resistance.
People weren't very eager to help. Local people were pretty much afraid of it. We would ride with people that we liked, and they would show us different sites, and they said, this is the grade school that will lose its tax base, and it has a championship basketball team, so we feel terrible about that, and our grandparents are buried in that cemetery over there, and the cemetery will be moved. We're so uneasy about this. We don't know whether to build a barn or sell our house.
My grandmother was one of the strongest opponents to the national park. I mean, she carried petitions all the time. It'd come up every 20 years. She'd fight it every 20 years. Now we have the Tallgrass Prairie National Preserve, And so here I am in the same county with something that the National Park Services thinks is important enough to protect. And really, my ranch is no different than that park. The very same grasses and forbs are there, and the animals, and so it's an incredible ecosystem.
Our mission is to conserve and preserve the natural and cultural resources here at Tallgrass Prairie National Preserve. The primary landowner here is the Nature Conservancy, and the Park Service is the primary land manager. So it's a cooperative management. We do own some of the land here, but we don't own all of it. So it is this joint partnership.
And we actually acquired the preserve, ownership of the private portion of the preserve in 2005. Mm-hmm. So that's when we really got tied in with this park.
The preserve, what took decades to establish as a public land area, is for the Tallgrass Prairie to have a representative piece of an ecosystem that was missing from the National Park Service.
I wonder, Elaine, in your view, why do you think it's important that we should have a preserve in terms, not ecological this time, but in terms of history? Why should we have this here?
Well, it's not represented in the national park system, and it's very, very rare, and the last remaining stands of original Tallgrass Prairie are right here in Kansas in the Flint Hills. And so to preserve an ecosystem was by far the most important reason for doing this.
Those words, I should say it this way, those words are so applicable to other situations in the country where other people now have the chance, the last chance in many cases, to preserve something that otherwise is going to be gone. And it was done here, I think, as you have just said, as Larry suggested, in the nick of time.
We have sort of a nature area as well, so it's not just a homestead. So it feels...
Bill McBride and his family were also inspired by Prairie Earth to make Chase County their home.
Connect them to other places in the prairie and be sort of an information center.
Green living is alive in Chase County. Architect McBride designed a home on the main highway that looks to the future and the past.
We bought this property that from West Jackson, and it's the old railroad property in just outside of Matfield Green, where there were cattle pens, where cattle were loaded and unloaded to get out to the, or coming in or going out to the pastures. And so the corrals are still here, and the total property is about 40 acres, and most of it is untilled prairie. So it's it's one of the reasons coming to Kansas was prairie, and so to actually have a piece of it is important. We built on this site, even though we have 40 acres, much of which is on the other side of the track, we decided not to build on anything that was undisturbed prairie. And so there's a railroad right away, or easement right here, so there's trucks coming in and out to service the railroad. And so we decided that the least intrusive on nature was to just build right here. Even though it was our property, it was being used by the railroad and it was ugly, and so we decided, well, that we'll just put our house there. And so then we, respecting the history of the site, we decided to model our house after a Santa Fe building from the 30s, which was a big lumber shed. And we took liberties, added more windows, but it's still of the same sort of construction type. We have a silo outside there where we store our roof water, and so we never did a well. So we're completely depending on rain, and so far after 3 years we haven't run out of water, so it's a good sign. It goes up and down, and sometimes we get a little nervous, and when it gets low we kick in a gray water recycling that we recycle everything but toilet water, So that takes a little it takes a little fussing around with the filters. And so when we don't need it, when we're flush with water, we don't use that system. But if we feel we're going into a time of scarcity, we'll start recycling the gray water. We have a wind generator, 10 kilowatt wind generator, Berge, and it's performed well, a few little problems, but we seem to be providing about probably 85 or 90% of all of our heating and cooling and all of our energy use. And but we are near the grid, so we are backed up by the grid. If there's a problem, we can just go flip right back over. We're right next to the railroad, have about 70 trains a day that rumble by. It's 100 and some feet over there. So we have good windows, and so when we close everything up, it's pretty quiet. But we've gotten very used to the trains anyway.
In one of the few such areas left in the United States, people on the tallgrass prairie have learned that the land instructs life. People must feel, listen, and in many ways surrender to the land so that living and even business can thrive.
One of those important dictates is that prairie needs, for example, prairie needs fire. So they learned how to work with fire, to use fire, to preserve the tallgrass prairie.
The burning culture of this area is unique to the country, as far as I know. I know of no other location where people burn like we burn in the Flint Hills.
Early spring is fire season on the tallgrass prairie. Setting fire clears last year's dormant, colorless growth. In this cycle of renewal, the prairie must essentially be destroyed each year. Jane Koger, one of a few female ranchers in the area, uses fire to renew the prairie, but she avoids constant fire year in and year out. Koger's use of patch burning allows the prairie to repair itself while making for abundant biodiversity.
And that's where you burn one-third, leave two-thirds, and rotate it around. And amazingly, cattle will find what's burned. and they will hammer it. We know that. They're going to make it look like a golf course. But the two-thirds of your pasture is getting a lot of rest. You don't have to build extra fences. It's not like rotational grazing where you move them through paddocks. They go because you've burned it. And the other two-thirds of the pasture will, they'll go back to a part of that, but one-third is going to get really tall. So also we have really tall grass prairie. One of the fun things about patch burn grazing, I mean, it's also the terrifying part, but one of the fun things is we get to have fire like nobody has fire. Because after you've got 2 or 3 years of growth, and especially in the last several years where we've had more than adequate moisture, we have a lot of fuel load, and it burns hot, and it'll burn off black.
When the fires are out, it takes a relatively short time for the prairie to regenerate. Life returns to the hills each year, but not everything that grows back is welcome.
The Flint Hills, on average, gets about 30, 35 inches of rain a year. That's plenty enough rain to support trees in a forest. And if we didn't watch out for trees, if it didn't burn in the spring, we'd look like the Ozarks. Nothing wrong with the Ozarks, but you can see a lot farther here.
The thing that we forget is the prairie did not have trees. We have all ground nesting birds because there weren't trees. So all along our creek areas now, we have trees. Now, and the other thing is if you go down there, many of those trees, probably 80% of them are all going to be less than 70 years old. I mean, so they weren't there historically.
And we have made a concentrated effort to get rid of them and keep them out. So we've taken a lot of flack about hating trees. And it's we don't hate trees. We just like them where they belong.
And this is grass country. It's not tree country. A weed is defined as a plant that's in the wrong place. And trees in the Flint Hills are weeds. They belong around the streams. They belong in around barns and houses. They don't belong in the pastures. A tree in the pasture is a weed.
One simple way to look at this is prairie chickens see a tree as a predator perch. When I say we take people out to see prairie chickens, those guys are booming. They're doing their spring mating ritual. They're on top of the hill. They don't care if there's any grass there.
Originally found in the tallgrass prairies, the greater prairie chicken prefers the largely undisturbed habitat of Chase County. Existing on a diet of seeds, insects, and plants, the prairie chicken now lives mainly in small segments of managed land, mostly in the Midwest.
For me, and I think for many people who come and visit the prairie, the signature bird of tallgrass prairie to me is the prairie chicken. In Prairie Earth, I have one entire chapter devoted to the prairie chicken. I just believed it was so important. But again, it's a bird that's struggling.
We've had actually a pretty significant increase in our prairie chicken numbers over the last 5 years, actually about a threefold increase. And we attribute that some of the management changes. We're providing more residual nesting habitat, we're not burning as much. We're still burning, but we're rotating our burns and trying to provide areas with at least a couple years of residual vegetation, which prairie chickens prefer that.
Lack of grasslands has forced the population drastically downward over the years, but the greater prairie chicken is not considered endangered. Jane Koger has lived on the prairie for most of her life, but prairie chickens were a more recent discovery.
But I came pretty late to prairie chickens. And over the years then, all that kind of changed for many reasons, you know, and none that I could specifically put my finger on. But when we decided to put the ranch in a conservation easement, we asked Brian about, because he said, Jane, you've got to have prairie chickens here. And I said, well, I've just never really looked for them. So we went out one morning and we did have prairie chickens in the bell, and they've been there for years and years and years.
Each spring, males gather on communal mating grounds, or leks, to attract females.
Where this lek is, this one mm-hmm. that's up here now, you can burn that every so often without throwing them out of whack since their lek's been burned?
No, they don't care. Those are the males. They would wish I'd burn it off every year. Even needing cover, I mean, I think it goes out of their brains that they need cover from coyotes and everything because they're so intent on attracting females. It's not even at that part. The burning, and in some ways even structures, don't impact a booming male. It's the nesting females that are so wary.
In one of the most unique collaborations anywhere between preservation and business, ranchers are now considered part-time environmentalists. Ranching is the primary enterprise in Chase County. And saving the tallgrass prairie isn't just environmentalism. It's smart business.
Going back to the time where I was working on Prairie Earth here, I learned very quickly never to use the word environmentalist. And then I learned that it was not good to use the word preservation or preservationist. The word that people here who were hostile to some of this would tolerate, not happy with, but they would tolerate, was conservation.
Mm-hmm.
That they would deal with. What is it that makes conservation palatable to some of these people who are formally against it? And I know in other parts of the country, all those terms are anathema mm-hmm. to certain people.
Mm-hmm. I think the change happened maybe 10, 15 years ago. One of the groups that got involved in doing conservation in the Flint Hills, and particularly in Chase County, was a group called the Tallgrass Legacy Alliance. That started about in, I think, 1998, somewhere in there. And this is a group, and I was part of that group as well, where we had producers at the table and conservationists. And we all listen to one another, and that's really what it took, is everybody sitting down and listening and no one trying to dominate, but everyone trying to listen and be respectful. I think from the environmental community, the realization that the ranching community is very emotionally attached to this landscape, that they have high reverence for the Flint Hills, that they don't want to trash it. It's not part of them. And the ranching community realized that the environmentalists were not wanting to take over, you know, their land, and that they didn't want to plant it all the trees. There was a misconception that you know, biologists, they love trees and they want to plant trees in the prairie and things like that. So we started realizing, man, we've got a lot of common ground.
I thought that you would be the leader in trying to show these people how ranching and sustainability have got to embrace certain environmental practices.
During that time, I changed from seeing cattle as the main focus to the natural resource as the main focus. And we talk about, are you going to sacrifice an ecosystem for the sake of this product, of beef, you know? Is a quarter pounder really worth losing all your prairie chickens over? I don't think so.
And the reason why we have this grass is because the farmers and ranchers in this area are caretakers. They're good conservationists. They may not be the flag or the you know the type of people that are really vocal about it, but that's what they do, and they do it very quietly.
The ranchers have realized that there are various threats to this to the Flint Hills that could take away the use of the land as they've been using it. Can't become a housing development. Can't become a wind factory. It can't become a it's all broken up and fragmented, that it's going to stay grassland. My son's a rancher. The rancher is the guy that has the headaches. The cowboy's the guy that gets to do the fun, gets to rope and ride, not have to worry about the cattle market or feeding him in the winter, things like that. But we do own, my wife and I, and Josh and his wife own a small herd of longhorn cows. But most of their work is pasturing other people's cattle, which is typical of Flint Hills ranching.
I'm Joshua's Gwen Hoy, and we're on the Flying W Ranch. And we're going to gather some cows and then bring them in here, work their calves, and then turn them out in the pasture they belong to. Flying W Ranch, which is about a 7,000 acre working cattle ranch and guest ranch. Thousand yearlings and 50 horses and 5 dogs and 12 chickens. I'm fifth generation rancher. I started off cowboying and then went into debt and became a rancher.
Get your rope out, you mother.
I always wanted to be a cowgirl, even when I was little, drew pictures of it and wrote stories about being a cowgirl. And I moved down here in 92 after I graduated from college and got a job on the working for Leanne Crowfoot. I grew up on a farm, but completely different from a ranch. I love riding. I really love riding. I love being outside, and I really enjoy animals. So those were my criteria. And I like cowboys, too.
This morning we gathered the last few cows that we had to calve out, and we doctored their babies. We gave them immunization shots and put fly tags in their ears and castrated the bulls, and then we turned them out on grass.
Well,
of all, hold it.
I've broken a leg and an arm, some ribs, about all my fingers, a knee. I think that's about it.
I try to exercise and do some yoga to help. One bull that we doctored, he had a prior injury. He had been fought with another bull and had a hip injury, but then he got foot rot, which is like athlete's foot, and we doctored him for that and then turned him out.
It's the best life in the world. I've worked in a dozen states on 100 ranches, been all over the place, and I've never found any place as beautiful and lush and perfect for ranching as the Flint Hills. I just absolutely love it. It's the best possible life.
Well, and we have the freedom to set our own schedule, and both of us absolutely love being outside, and with the agritourism, it's really easy and nice to share that with other people and share our love of the Flint Hills and why we want to save it and protect it, and with our daughter also.
For me, as America, the world, becomes ever more congested, this is a place that still feels open. And we really feel the Great Plains start to open up. And you think that, okay, maybe we don't have too many people in the country. I think we do, but this is a place where you can put that frightful truth behind you for a while and think, we have space, we have room, we can breathe. This is the place where you first want to use that phrase, big sky. I know there's sky above Pennsylvania, and there's sky above Georgia, and there's sky above Maine.
And Montana.
But coming this way, this is the first place where you look at the horizon and you start seeing 360 degrees, and it's not 2 miles off. It's 30 miles away from you. So we're talking about a very large circle here with nothing but sky.
People came to this country as individuals from particular countries. And it wasn't until they moved across the prairie and they were whittled and honed by the wind. And on this prairie, the American spirit was born.
I got gosh, it's a wonderful landscape. One of my greatest pleasures of my life is to be out helping Josh Gwynn get a cow in shipping season, get out in the pasture, and it's still dark, and you know, it gets a little lighter. Long before the sun actually comes up, the stars start fading, but there'll be one star that it'll almost be there when the sun comes up.
The tallgrass prairie is most exciting for the wide open spaces and no trees. So you really, it's rolling flatness according to my friends in Colorado, but really there is, it's not flat like Kansas is known to be. And the prairie with its wildflowers and its variety of birds and mammals is just, it's just incredible.
How is the tallgrass prairie linked to the American spirit or soul, if we can use those terms?
I think when you come through and walk out on the prairie for the first time and you have this sense of expanse and this wide, big sky and these big rolling hills, and you know that what you're walking on hasn't ever been plowed and it's been there since the Ice Age, and it's just between this grass and those stars that you begin to sense your connectedness to the earth.
I think I'll continue to live here. It's been 35 years. We've got a nice place to live. I live adjoining to the Tallgrass Prairie Preserve. That's my neighbor. And so I'm going to live here the rest of my life as far as I know. And my next stop's going to be Arlington National Cemetery. So I like the view from there. Now, they have beautiful grass too.
So I know now where I belong, and someone asked me, now where do you live? And I've always said, I live in Maine, but I come here in the winter. Now, out of my, just spontaneously, I said, I live here. And I go to Maine in the summer, where I have lots of grandchildren. So that's such a, I feel so good about this. It's strong and clear.
There's a lot of it that has remained the same, really. But there's, of course, a lot of different people, but there's the same loving feeling.
We are an entity that has some rich, deep roots, that we have heritage, we have a reason to feel proud of ourselves, even though it's a county that's considered to be growing older and losing population, that it's a place where people can come back to and a place to live forever.
The changes that I've seen in the 2 decades since the book PrairyErth came out have been so impressive to me, coming back here after all those years. This would have to be a dream. That couldn't happen. But I'm pinching and I'm not waking up, so maybe it did happen. I'm really proud of Chase County for the changes that they've made. They've taken some possibilities that PrairyErth, the book, brought them, as I see it. They've taken those possibilities and they've worked with them, and they've been willing to look at things in a new way. And some of the negativism that I thought was almost prevalent here 2 decades ago, I don't see that much anymore. There's still naysayers, but there are plenty of yaysayers now, and they're the ones that are shaping things. And so that Chase County today is, I think, this, it's an enlightened place. It's no longer a dark corner of Kansas or of the country. This place, with what they've done just 2 decades, it gives me hope for America.